Dr. Rick Richards was president and co-founder of DOC, Doctors Ought to Care, when he discovered that Marlboro logos proliferated throughout popular video arcade games. And the rest is history. Rick?
Good morning. Let's tell the story. How would you like to start?
Well, where were you when you noticed that these games were appearing? Were you a gamer?
Well, actually, I was. I was on the faculty at the Medical College of Georgia in Augusta, Georgia, Department of Family Medicine. And on the way home from the medical college was a establishment called Norman's Electronic Gallery. That's what it was. And I would stop there. We were doing youth and tobacco, youth and alcohol, youth and poor food, youth and drugs. We're looking at those things from a research standpoint. But I would stop by there to watch the kids and the video games. This is early in the video game era, I would say late 80s, early 90s. And it occurred to me from watching the kids that the feedback from a good score or a good hit or a good race was much like the reaction that someone might have to a favorable drug. And I thought they were, you know, it's like the monkey hitting the lever and getting the food. I would watch the kids play these games, and I started playing to see what it was about. And I played, I want to say, Grand Prix Monaco for the first time. And I was stunned to be exposed to Marlboro after Marlboro after Marlboro ad. The car was similar to the Marlboro race car, Formula One. The billboards on the side had Marlboro with the red roof logo. The flags hanging over the racetrack had the Marlboro logo. I was stunned at the literally dozens of Marlboro ads that you could be exposed to for a quarter. So I checked out some others and found a number of other games that had Camel ads, that had John Player Special ads, that had the most prevalent one was Marlboro. It was in quite a few of the games. And I'm sitting in a building that might be 1,000 square feet, and multiple machines had cigarette ads and alcohol ads in them. Now, understanding that each image in a video game is programmed to be there, purposeful, I got to wondering who was paying for it, who was responsible for it, because somebody had to put it there. It's not like when they say, oh, that ad was on in a movie by chance, which we now know years later was product placement, or this billboard comes up on turn three in the Charlotte Motor Speedway. Well, that just happens to get the TV camera. This is advertising aimed at the people who attend the races. It's clear in video games it was purposely built for the video game audience, which at that time was near 100% kids. In fact, I was the only adult ever in the video arcade.
Wow. You know, I think the time period, I think you may have actually been doing this well into the 1980s.
Could have been. I don't remember. That's what, 30 years ago? 40 years ago.
Yeah, close.
So, I'd have to look at the articles for the exact timing of it. But it was quite early, the video games. It's when the video games were in an arcade, not on the computer.
Right, and they would sit in it and be almost immersed in the game.
Correct. It was one of those. Some of them were like pinball machines, where you had a cabinet and there was a board in front of you. Some of them were like a TV, the Pong game, where you had a console, and then the racing games were generally a cabinet that you actually got into and sat down in a car type seat with a steering wheel, brake, and accelerator, as though you were actually in a race car. And the visual from the screen was what you would see through the windshield or front of your car.
Well, it's amazing what you really discovered. First of all, you predicted what is now actually a known psychiatric disorder of gaming disorder. And the other aspect is that nobody had picked up the phone or written a letter to find out, what do you do about this?
Well, not to my knowledge. And when I would bring it up to people, they would say, oh, they're just trying to make it look real. And I would say, well, yeah, but they're targeting kids. They're just trying to make a realistic Monaco experience. They're just trying to make a realistic NASCAR experience. And there were a lot of games out coming out in the year two, three after that that had NASCAR racetracks, motorcycle racetracks, in addition to the Formula One racetrack. In fact, you could sit down in these and you could select which racing experience you wanted to have, all of them with cigarette advertising.
Now, you and I had been tracking televised racing and other sporting events, and had gotten some, so to speak, mileage out of the issue by calling attention to it. But you then separately went to, did you contact the video game companies, the tobacco companies, both, or issued press releases? What was the?
I wrote to Philip Morris. I wrote to, if I remember right, Sega, SEGA Games. I wrote to Namco, which was another one. I sent letters to the editors of a number of newspapers. And it wasn't until one of the newspapers, I don't remember which one, it was might have been Washington, New York, actually paid attention to it.
I think it was the Washington Post.
Okay, actually paid attention to what I was saying. They wrote an article on it that it picked up some steam. And as I remember, about the time that the article came out, after I had spent months trying to get someone to pay attention, a lawyer from Philip Morris just happened to walk by one of the video games and just happened to see it. And as a result, wrote a letter to one of those companies, I want to say Sega, and told them it was a copyright infringement. Well, this thing had been out for at least a year, if not two or three. And the game was distributed all over the world. And to think that nobody had noticed it before I did and contacted them before I did is absurd. Certainly people did. And they chose to ignore it.
Yeah, it's always, we've always been you know, chasing after them. And they've always found an incredible way to circumvent really everything that they claim that they won't do. And this was just such a great example. And so direct, one of the very few examples, actually, where you could literally say they were aiming at kids.
Yeah, well, it has metastasized since then. In the NASCAR Winston Cup Series, it metastasized to the NASCUBS, which was a comic book series about NASCAR racing, which included all of the cigarette ads as well. I was never able to confirm that R.J. Reynolds paid for the Winston advertising at the kids, but it was clear somebody wrote that information in so that it was aimed at young people younger than 7, 8, 9.
Well, I didn't.
The other one we found. Go ahead.
I didn't remember the NASCUBS. I do remember Racing for Kids, where they would airbrush out whatever logos they spotted, but we still found many Winston logos that they didn't realize were still in the photographs, as well as Skoal and other tobacco products.
Yeah, the NASCUBS was a takeoff on the NASCAR Winston Cup Series, and it was a six-panel comic, just like, you know, Batman, Superman, those comics at the time, certainly aged at young people. But speaking of Batman, we actually found a Marlboro billboard in a Batman comic.
Wow.
We were not able to confirm that it was placed there by Philip Morris, but there were no other ads, just Marlboro in the comic book. And it was behind a villain who was coming down off of a building toward Batman. So a number of product placements specifically aimed at children. And when the Sega console game came out for home use, it still had the ads in it.
It's just amazing. I'm speechless. I think you did an incredible thing, and I'm just proud that you were able to expose them and let them get on the defensive for a change.
Well, it points out several things, Alan. One of which is they don't care unless somebody says something. That's one. Unless the somebody who says something is willing to put time and effort into it to get somebody who has a forum to expose them to public ridicule, it doesn't mean anything. And even after that, they're going to metastasize into another process, keep getting their message across to the audience. So you've got to be eternally vigilant to trace the cell line so that you can maintain pressure in the public forum for them to stop aiming at kids.